Coming up in today's newscast, Palestinians and Israeli defense forces clash in the West Bank following the end of U.S. aid payments to the PA. Iran unveils a new cruise missile, and Israelis start making preparations ahead of Super Bowl 53.
An attempted stabbing attack at the Tomb of the Patriarchs was foiled by IDF soldiers on Sunday after an Arab resident of Hebron was caught entering the holy site armed with a knife. According to Israeli police reports, the roughly 20-year-old Palestinian suspect first walked towards the security inspection post with a group of tourists, but the suspect was behaving suspiciously and did not appear to border police to be a part of the larger group. So they pulled him aside for a closer inspection. Well, their suspicions proved fruitful when the suspect, found out by security, pulled a large kitchen knife from out from under his clothing. With weapons aimed at the ready, however, he threw the knife to the ground and raised his hands in the air. No injuries were reported, and the suspect was detained for further questioning. Initial reports confirmed that he was there with intent to carry out a stabbing terror attack, though. Clashes between Palestinians and Israeli soldiers broke out near the West Bank village of Al-Mughayr on Friday when security forces responded to rioters who were throwing stones.
The IDF then reportedly responded with tear gas and stun grenades, though the Red Crescent claims that 15 were injured as a result of live fire. And this is the same area where last week a 38-year-old Palestinian man was killed in clashes with Israeli settlers. Though accounts of that incident differ widely, and an investigation is still underway. Elsewhere, also on Friday, two more major operations came to an end. The mandate of the temporary international presence in Hebron, or the TIPH, and U.S. aid payments to the PA, much of which were spent on security cooperations with Israel. And though arguably more serious, security wasn't the only thing affected by the anti-U.S. aid at the beginning of ATCA, or the Anti-Terrorism Clarification Act. Work on many special and municipal projects, schools, clinics, etc. were also brought to a halt.
أول شيء إحنا اكتشفنا قبل ثلاث أربعة أيام أو أكثر شوية إنه الأمريكان وقفوا المشروع وبالطريقة عرفنا إنه يعني بدأ الناس اللي قائمين على المشروع طبعا وقفوا العمل وهم عاملين حفريات في الشارع هلقيت كل الناس اللي موجودة اللي بتروح وبتيجي في الشارع حال طبعا اللي عنده سيارة اتضررت اللي عنده بسكليت اتضررت أنا يعني أنا بشوف ناس كثير ماشيين في الشارع حتى الناس اللي عاديين ماشيين على رجلهم والله ما هم عارفين يمشوا على رجلهم من الحفريات هاي
اشتغلنا سنة وعلى أساس إنه في خمس سنوات حتكون لنهاية المشروع ل 2020 فأنا يعني كنت بجهز ببيتي وفي تشطيبات كانت عندي في البيت كتبت على نفسي كمبيالات ومبالغ كبيرة علي لعدة أشخاص ف هنا انا انت بتفاجئني في امر انه بتقول لي انتهى عملك انه ما فيش رجعه فيش عوده للعمل فهين انا كيف كمحمد بدي اسدد ديون كيف بدي اعمل كيف بدي اسلك الناس هذه طبعا اكيد انه حيكون نهايه السجن.
Senior Palestinian official Saeb Erekat called the United States' move extortion, explaining that they had no other choice and were forced by the U.S. into denying aid. But senior advisor to the White House and Middle East peace envoy Jason Greenblatt tweeted in response that the PA was being disingenuous. Quote, "This aid was cut, not just suspended, at the PA's request because they didn't want to be subject to the United States courts, which would require them to pay United States citizens killed by Palestinian terrorists when the PA was found guilty," end quote. Greenblatt continued to charge that the PA has money for health and education, but must use their money wisely. For example, quote, "Stop rewarding terrorists who kill Israelis. That will save the PA a fortune. They can also work with the United States and others to help improve their economy and need even less foreign aid," end quote.
Meanwhile, as the IDF clashed with Palestinians in the West Bank, Israel's southern security forces were also on guard, preventing infiltrations and attacks along the Gaza border.
On Friday, roughly 10,000 Palestinians again came to the Gaza-Israel border to riot, throw stones and explosives, attempt to infiltrate or damage the fence, burn tires, and more. The IDF responded with rubber-coated rounds and some live fire. And then on Sunday morning, the army arrested five Palestinians who had crossed illegally into Israel from the southern Gaza Strip. The men were not armed, however, and were transferred to the Shin Bet for further questioning. But despite these and other weekend incidents, Hamas is said to be mulling a reduction in the violent outbursts along the border as part of negotiations with Egypt. In return, the Rafah border crossing between Egypt and Gaza would be reopened, a move that would be highly popular for Hamas at a time that the Gaza terror group is fighting for survival both from Israel and the West Bank. Hamas has become increasingly isolated following the PA's decision to dissolve its government and form a new one without Hamas members. Hamas's parliamentary and government officials in the West Bank and East Jerusalem have even been arrested by PA forces recently, now that they've lost their diplomatic immunities. And Israel, in the meantime, has vowed that neither elections in the Palestinian Authority nor in Israel would prevent a heavy military response to Hamas's escalation from the Strip.
All right, by the way, in an update to this last story, the five Gaza suspects arrested crossing into Israel earlier this morning were later found to have hidden knives and wire cutters on their persons. Then later, two Jordanian nationals were arrested crossing the border illegally into Israel from Jordan, but they were not reportedly armed. They, too, were taken in for questioning, though. Now, moving to Iran, the Islamic regime is celebrating the anniversary of the country's 1979 Islamic Revolution by displaying a new cruise missile with a range of up to 800 miles or 1,300 kilometers. And regardless of heavy criticisms from the United States and Europe, Tehran still insists that their ever-expanding missile program is purely defensive. That being said, at the same time, senior IRGC officials have also suggested that attempts to stop their ICBM program would only result in its advancement.
Now, while it's true that Iran often exaggerates its military capabilities, this most recently unveiled surface-to-surface missile called Hovayze is no joke. It was added to Iran's weapons arsenal in 2015, and since then, it's been greatly improved upon. Following more recent ICBM and satellite launch tests, the head of the Iranian Guard Corps' Aerospace Division claims to have solved initial issues in the missile's engines. Additionally, Defense Minister Amir Hatami told state media that the missile can fly at low altitudes, can be prepared and fired in a short time, and has accurately hit targets from up to 1,200 kilometers away during tests. In fact, a video purportedly demonstrating this was even released over the weekend, though the video has not yet been independently verified. Finally, however, in response, while speaking at this week's weekly security cabinet meeting, Israeli Prime Minister Netanyahu reiterated that Israel is on top of the situation.
באיראן מציינים היום 40 שנה למהפכה האסלאמית. הם מנסים להתהדר בטיל חדש. איראן מצהירה בגלוי על כוונתה להשמיד את מדינת ישראל. יש לי מסר ברור לרודנים בטהרן. אנחנו יודעים מה אתם עושים, ואנחנו יודעים איפה אתם עושים זאת. אנחנו נמשיך לפעול נגד איראן בכל הכלים העומדים לרשותנו כדי להבטיח את ביטחון ישראל, כדי להבטיח את עתיד ישראל.
According to new landmark reports by journalist Yoav Yitzchak, it seems that Attorney General Avichai Mandelblit has now found himself between a rock and a hard place, as both State Prosecutor Shai Nitzan and Prime Minister Netanyahu have allegedly gathered dirt on the top legal official. Nitzan supposedly has recordings of Mandelblit that allegedly prove he interfered with an investigation in 2015, and Netanyahu reportedly has a letter written by former State Attorney Yehuda Weinstein that apparently proves the same thing. And Yitzchak's report then alleges that Mandelblit is being squeezed from both sides with this dirt to both release and not release his indictment recommendations against Netanyahu. Well, joining me now with more is legal advisor to the Israeli Movement of Governability and Democracy, or Meshilut, attorney Simcha Rotman. Simcha, thank you so much for coming back in again as well.
Thank you for having me.
All right, so, you know, how credible do you think this report is, that Attorney General Mandelblit is being kind of hit from both sides here?
I think that we need to take it with a grain of salt. It's to say that he's being extorted on this information, which has already been released many times in the past. I think it's a little bit too much.
But
I think that we have a problem, and the problem is that in Israel, the position of the state prosecutor, the chief prosecutor, and the attorney general, and the chief legal advisor is all in one person. This creates tensions that a normal human being should not stand. In normal places, the prosecution of, especially the prosecution of, we see how it goes in the U.S., you have a special prosecutor, you have a special attorney dealing with this kind of issue, because to have this kind of burden on the regular law enforcement forces to investigate head of states, it's not for them. It creates a problem. It creates a false motivation within the prosecution to prosecute the prime minister, even if there is something there, even if there is not. Then you have to change the system. And what we see today, and it will only become worse after he releases his recommendation, we'll see more of that. And the system has to be changed.
Well, first of all, we have yet to know what Mandelblit's recommendation will be,
of course,
one way or
and
the other.
It doesn't matter what he will recommend.
Of when it comes out. So that's first. But second of all, you know, how do you suspect Mandelblit? Because you mentioned this is an old story. This is known to the public. It's not something that was necessarily hidden. So how do you think Mandelblit is supposed to respond to this? Is he supposed to respond?
I think that Mandelblit needs to if there is some this kind of information, has to release it voluntarily and say, this and this, I'm being under pressure. I think the best way to relieve this kind of pressure is just saying that. Saying, this and this person trying to extort me, and if it's true. And what I find...
Well, that's it. That's quite the accusation.
What I find bothering is that we know that when Prime Minister Sharon was investigated, someone from within the prosecution, an attorney, was trialed for leaking information to the public, because she had a political motive to leak information to the public. What we see today, we see more and more information from within closed rooms that goes to the media, and no one does anything about it, especially not Mandelblit. And I think if there is something that he should be... if any problem Mandelblit has is the fact that he's not fighting these leaks from within the state prosecution time and again, and that's what he needs to focus on. And I think once he starts doing he won't be under pressure.
But again, if Mandelblit were to respond to these leaks, doesn't he give them credence?
He needs to say
he can't say that they're false, because if they're not, then he's backtracking from in the future. And he can't acknowledge them, because as you said, it's a leak.
If there is a leak just released yesterday from the room that he sits and how the people who he consults with, there are ways to deal with it. You do a polygraph test on everyone who was in the room. That's the way you do in cabinet meetings sometimes. That's the way you do in special forces. That's the way you do in the police from time to time. That's the way to deal with it. And if there are leaks, then he needs to consult with less people, if that's the issue. And I think that the fact that we don't see... No one from in all the last few years, no one was prosecuted for leaking information. I think that's a big stain on the prosecution of Israel. And I think I can believe now, the public can believe now, almost every story you can mention.
All right. Well, with that, we'll have to obviously see how Mandelblit responds to this, if at all. Sehwat, thank you so much for coming in.
Thank you.
After a long period of uncertainty over whether the project would be completed in time or not, Israel inaugurated on Thursday its new Leviathan natural gas field off the coast in the Mediterranean. And speaking at the ceremony, Prime Minister Netanyahu again lauded all the good that is to come from this latest platform.
Among other things, the Prime Minister explained that Leviathan is a critical component of the strategic, energy, economic, and diplomatic strength of Israel, and that it will connect Israel literally and diplomatically to Europe as well as to the Arab world.
ישראל הופכת למעצמה אנרגטית, ישראל עצמאית, היא לא תלויה באף אחד לצורכי האנרגיה שלנו.
Additionally, Energy Minister Dr. Yuval Steinitz called the inauguration a holiday for the energy economy and for all citizens of Israel.
האסדה כאן מאחוריי תאפשר לנו לסגור את תחנת הכוח הפחמית שם בחדרה, שלפי הדוחות מזהמת את האוויר והורגת כל שנה מאות אזרחים בישראל. האסדה כאן תאפשר לנו הכנסות אדירות, אבל חשוב לא פחות, עתיד בריא ונקי יותר ל8.5 מיליון אזרחי מדינת ישראל.
Environmentalists, lawmakers, and many residents are angry over the move, however, as their warnings about the drill site have gone unheeded. In particular, alarms have been sounded regarding the Leviathan's production platform. Spills and leaks are cited as a matter of when and not if, and the platform is connected to a larger Leviathan field via subsea platform, and it's located just 10 kilometers away from the shore of a popular beach. All petitions to push the platform further out to sea have failed.
On Saturday, hundreds of thousands marched in Venezuela to support the leader of the opposition and the head of the National Assembly, Juan Guaido, as the interim president of the country. They also protested against the government of Nicolas Maduro, and of course, this massive rally had support from around the world, including in Israel. Well, LTV's Joy Gabijon is here with all the details. Joy.
Hi, Aaron. Yes, so as you mentioned, Venezuelan immigrants gathered in Tel Aviv, Haifa, and Jerusalem to express their support for Guaido and to thank Israel for the recognition of the head of the opposition as the legitimate interim president of their country. People showed up to the rallies wrapped up in the Venezuelan flag, they sang the national anthem, and they even brought some signs written both in Hebrew and in Spanish.
All right, and this while in Venezuela, specifically in Caracas, hundreds of thousands gathered to demand Maduro's resignation.
Yes, exactly. The demonstration in Caracas was massive, and people seemed a little bit more optimistic this time. And once again, they showed their support for Juan Guaido as the interim president until new democratic elections are called for. They claimed to be very close to a change, and they thanked the international community, including Israel, for helping with this.
All right. Well, you know, it took some time, but Netanyahu did finally recognize Guaido as the new leader last week. But that wasn't a move that was free of repercussions either.
Yes, well, Netanyahu was following the United States, Canada, Spain, France, and many other countries in South America. So they are pressuring for new elections in the country. On the other side, though, following Cuba, Bolivia, and the Palestinian Authority, among others, it looks like another country, actually Israel's main enemy, the Iranian regime, has also now expressed support for Nicolas Maduro. According to a report from Iran's official news agency, President Rouhani has also condemned the U.S.'s intervention in Venezuela's issues.
All right, well, that's something that was a bit expected, considering that the government, as you said,
exactly.
You know, Maduro's government and the Iranian have been in contact for years, and he's actually gotten a lot of support from Iran over the years.
Yes.
All right, well, so now let's go back a little bit to, you know, what happened at the rally.
Okay, well, during the protest, Juan Guaido announced the creation of an international coalition for humanitarian aid. He talked about 3 points of for the collection of the aid, one in Cúcuta in Colombia, another one in Brazil, and the third one in the Caribbean. And he urged the military not to try to stop the entry of this help.
Which gives a little bit of hope.
Yes, it does, but that wasn't all. Guaido also called for the military officials to rebel on the oppression of Maduro, that's what he said, mm-hmm. And this because of only a few hours before the massive march, a high-ranking Venezuelan Air Force general published a video where he recognized Guaido, something big. In his statement, Janice Rodriguez said that 90% of the armed forces do not support what he called the dictator and stand by the Venezuelan people.
All right, well, we are following everything that's happening in Venezuela very closely, and we'll be back, of course, with more on this hopefully soon. Thank you, Joy, for your report.
Of course, Aaron.
On a related note, Israeli Eurovision winner and star Netta Barzilai is making headlines and topping charts again this week with the release of Basa Sababa, her newest and first single since winning the song contest last year. Further, with the added release of a flashy music video, Barzilai explains that Basa Sababa presents a far more realistic and raw version of female empowerment. Translated from Hebrew and Arabic slang, Basa Sababa means bummer, that's cool. And in an interview with the Associated Press, Barzilai explained that the song's message reflects the emotional roller coaster that she's been on since winning Eurovision, as well as the lessons that she's learned from that same experience.
I just thought about all this Eurovision experience. You know, I was this idol for people. I was this idol for empowerment, for self-love, for self-acceptance. Am I your idol? Like, how? Why? And it miraculously empowered me. So it's a circle of empowerment. I was suddenly this, what they told me that I am. And it was amazing to feel that way. There was also, with popularity, there's a lot of love, but there's a lot of hate as well. And it was magically, I felt it like sliding off me. And I was thinking about something primal, something like a spirit animal that symbolizes all that. And I found the rhino, like its skin is so thick, you know, and it's so strong. And, you know, it attacks its problems instead of running away from them. And, you know, its horn is, it's almost flipping you off. Like, I don't care what you think about me. That is, you know, the spirit of the song. I am chasing and facing my problems with positivity and power and a festival. And that is Basa Sababa.
Now, Barzilai wrote Basa Sababa in partnership with Avshalom Ariel and Stav Berger, who also worked on Toy. And the video was filmed at 13 locations across Kiev and the Ukraine at a cost of around 1 million shekels, which, according to Channel 12, makes Basa Sababa the most expensive Israeli music video ever produced, featuring a crew of 250 people, 50 dancers, and one giant pink rhino. In other news, nearly 150,000 Israelis flocked to the various Israeli national parks this weekend for the first days of the annual Darom Adom, or Red South, festival. And for the festival, which takes place over every weekend of February and the first weekend of March, Israelis pour out of the cities and into the fields to gaze upon a sea of blooming red anemone flowers, or kalaniot.
Additionally, locals and visitors alike will be treated to beautiful restaurants, cafes, galleries, and more with the backdrop of the mesmerizing red flowers. And finally, this year's festival will also feature events like bike marathons, poetry readings, concerts by Israeli artists, and much, much more, all across the Negev, the Eshkol region, and elsewhere. Perhaps most exciting about this festival, however, is that it follows a year of near-constant attacks from Gaza. In fact, over 7,000 acres of land have been burnt up since March of 2018 by hundreds, if not thousands, of incendiary kites and balloons flown over the border from Gaza. They didn't stop the kalaniot from blooming, though, nor did they prevent upwards of 60,000 Israelis from coming to the nature reserves and fields near the Gaza border communities over the weekend to view the flowers in full bloom. And actually, festival organizers are even expecting similar, if not higher, numbers of visitors in the coming weeks.
All right, now get a load of this. Appetites across the Jewish state were completely eliminated this weekend when a video from a local Domino's pizza franchise went viral.
יו. זה דומינוס פיצה במרכז הכרמל בחיפה.
אני מעלה את זה גם לסטורי, הזין שלי.
תראו את זה. דומינוס פיצה.
בגלל זה אני מרגיש
טוב. יש בו עכברים בפיצה.
The video is sent to Israeli news networks over the weekend, and it quite literally shows at least four rats going to town on Domino's dough and flour, both inside and around a pizza tray in the window. And thankfully for Haifa resident Gil Yehuda, who shot this video, he spotted the feasting rodents by chance and before, not after, having eaten at this location. But in response to the video, a Domino's pizza spokesperson added that they too were shocked by that sight, and that the branch in question is and will remain closed for now over sanitary issues. That being said, apparently this branch has been fighting an infestation for some time now, a battle that Domino's blames on local renovations. It was explained that this location borders the Carmelit subway, which is undergoing major renovations whose works are, quote, creating an unprecedented plague of pests. We've contacted the municipality several times to address this issue immediately, end quote. Regardless, it doesn't look like anyone will be too quick to return to this pizzeria anytime soon. Now, it may not be the most popular sport in Israel, and it's certainly not airing at a very reasonable hour, but thousands of Israelis are still gearing up Sunday for Super Bowl 53 between the LA Rams and the New England Patriots.
Slated to premiere in Israel at 1:30 a.m. on Monday, dozens of bars and restaurants across the country are listing themselves online and or are even selling tickets to Super Bowl showing events, each expecting hundreds of patrons to arrive. But while there are of course many Americans present at these events who love and understand football, and now there's even an Israeli football league, most of the viewers in the Jewish state are watching for the commercials, the atmosphere of watching together, and of course the halftime show. In fact, in a hilariously telling video published by the Jewish agency, Israelis try and fail to answer basic questions about the sport, like what does NFL stand for, what happens in a football game, and what is a quarterback.
I would say that for a touch ball, it will be probably 10 plus.
Touchdown is 12, I think. And field goal is 6 or 3? 3.
Score, I don't know. Soccer is much easier.
I say like 30 for a field goal.
And now for our Hebrew word of the day, the annual Darom Adom, or Red South Festival, has begun again. So today's word is Adom, which means red. Now, as you may have guessed, there are many red things, or dvarim adumim, that we can talk about. Stop signs, blood, cherries, lipstick, etc. But there's more. There's also the Magen David Adom, which is the Israeli version of the Red Cross, and of course, red poppies, or kalaniot adumot, like the ones at the Darom Adom Festival. So, if you happen to be in town, make sure to check out the event at this year's celebrations. You've never seen a dome like this in your life. Now, let's go ahead and take a look at the weather forecast. Tonight should be partly cloudy and cool with lows of about 54 or 12 degrees Celsius. Then tomorrow you can expect clear to partly cloudy skies and a rise in temperatures to a warm high of 75 or 24 degrees Celsius. All right, that's it for today's news. Today's exchange rate is 3.64 shekels to the American dollar. Remember to sign up for our daily newsletter at iltv.tv. And don't forget to follow us on Facebook at Israel English News and on Twitter at iltv news. I'm Aaron Porras. Thank you for watching.